Good evening and welcome to The Checkpoint. Thank you for keeping it urban. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Now, today we are going to be talking about the implementation of the NRM manifesto since its out re-election in 2016. However, this discussion has come in the middle of the week when we've had the budget speech and some sad news. We lost as a country. The other day, the country woke up to the death of Major General Kasirye Gwanga Samuel Waswa. It is really indeed sad news. However, our guest tonight is Honorable Captain Francis Babu. Captain Francis, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, and good evening to our viewers.
Captain, before we go into our discussion today, could you pay tribute to Major General Kasirye Gwanga?
Thank you very much. I'd like to send my condolences, first of all, to the family, secondly, to the UPDF, thirdly, to His Excellency the President, and to all Ugandans. Kasirye Gwanga has been an outstanding officer. And if you look at his history, which we should not repeat here, he's gone through a lot. And why? Because of this country. If you were to describe him like the British do, he's been an officer and a gentleman. Maybe his methods were slightly unorthodox, but he did make his point. And he did not do anything for selfish reasons. To him, it was service above self. He was a man who liked everybody. I was watching a small document yesterday when the market people were saying how he used to go there and buy things and how he would buy people meat and give them food and things like that. And even in the villages where he stayed, he helped people. So he was a man who was destined to try and help this country. He was a true Ugandan. Now, there are very few people like that. And for that reason, whatever misgivings one might have, I think we'd like to wish him and you know, an eternal rest. And like we say, may his soul rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Do you think the country will ever get such towering soldiers?
We have them. We have them. But we have a problem in this country. We have too many selfish people who make others not breathe. I think I better use the American expression. They sort of stop others who would have those kind of qualities in progressing in this country. But we have them. We have 45 million people approximately. And we definitely have some good people in every sector of our country. And I think this is where we need to be very sincere. Baganda have a saying, Awakure nume, tewakuremu. So there's bound to be others. And maybe not with these methods, but slightly different methods, but achieving the same goal.
The same goal.
For this country.
Captain, today was the budget day. The Minister for Finance, Matia Kasaija, delivered the budget speech on behalf of the President. But for me, the concern is that we continue as a country to run a recurrent budget where the largest chunk of the money goes to administrative costs and things like loan repayment. Does this concern you as well?
Yeah, well, the loan repayment you can do very little about, because you borrow money because you want to do certain things in the country, which is building the economy. So development budget, where we borrow a lot of money, is something that you cannot run away from, especially with our kind of income that we have in this country. However, the administrative budget, I agree with you entirely. We need to sit down and review it. I am of the view that we've made a lot of mistakes. For example, I do not agree with the top-heavy parliament and the executive arm of government, to start from that point of view. The civil service has been trimmed many times. It can be reviewed. They also started some agencies of government. Now, one can sit down and review all these things, but where we are going, we have to trim. We have to leave in our budget. In other words, we've got to cut the cloth according to our size. We can't go on spending money. And therefore, His Excellency the President, he wrote a paper, The Real Economy versus a Vulnerable Economy. Now, if you're talking about vulnerable economy, it means that the real economy has to be trimmed to be able to include. You want to have an economy that is all-inclusive. And that requires to trim the administrative costs. Now, the administrative costs are definitely high. Personally, I think we can cut that parliament to half. How? By saying that every representative represents half a million people. If those are too many, you can say 300,000. Even 250 alone would bring the parliament down to 200. And these special groups, we've demonstrated that these people are important, they have taken part. We could also reduce them, if not completely do away with them. I really don't see why we should have special groups in parliament. And if we did, maybe one to represent a group of people. But as far as I'm concerned, we even have municipalities that have got 2,000 people electing a member of parliament, as opposed to another group which has got 200,000 people. So the whole thing is an amorphous. We need to review this very seriously.
How do you get to that point of trying to review the structure of administration in this country? Because time and again, so many people have talked about it and have made several proposals. But how do you get to that point where, as a country, you sit and decide that probably we now have to trim our administrative costs, so we have to bring down, because it will, for example, mean loss of jobs. So how do you make that decision as a leader?
You see, the problem is historical. When we got independence, because the British had ruled us for over 70 years or so, they came up with their system, the Westminster system of government. And so we used that one. It did not work very well. Within a few years, it had gone to shambles. We went to a one-party system. Eventually, we came up with a military government, and eventually, we came back to the so-called multi-party system. And then, of course, we had the movement system. All these are historical. We've been experimenting, really. We have never found a system that suits us. We are copying. We are copycats. So what apparently has happened is you've got to look at the cost. These are numbers. They don't deceive. If you look at the amount of money being spent on a parliament, amount of money being spent on the executive, it's quite a lot. Now, you're talking about jobs. Jobs is not only in political leadership. We've got to create other areas where jobs can be achieved. A lot of these young people, even those in parliament, are qualified to work in other organizations, or they can start their own companies and they can become entrepreneurs. Now, as far as I'm concerned, I think that's a different argument. We should not use that one to stop us trimming so that we can fulfill the vulnerable economy. The vulnerable economy is where we want just very basic things, like giving somebody food, shelter, medicine, and give them all the other things that they require. And as far as I'm concerned, we need to go to that vulnerable economy because the people of this country are not very happy. Recently, when the president did his speech for the State of the Nation, somebody said that he was in a taxi and said, but what the president is saying is not for us. We ordinary people, this doesn't concern us. Now, that is the attitude people have. How do we change that attitude? And the only way to change attitude is start looking at our model and start seeing where we can save money and bring everybody on board. You need to do that. And quickly, not later. This business of later doesn't work. We've got to make a decision. And it's this decision that we have to make. I was happy when the president was on the Heroes Day. He said he's fed up with parasites. And I think time has come. And he has used another word, integrity. We need people with integrity. People to speak for this country, not for selfish reasons. We have a lot of people who are extremely selfish, and they are giving us a lot of problems.
Captain, you highlight the president's speech on Heroes Day, and he has time and again talked about, or I could say lamented about, corruption in this country. And the prime minister equally during the manifesto week said one of the challenges that have been an impediment to implementing the NRM manifesto has been corruption. But it seems to be sounding, it's more now of like a rhetoric. How do we get out of this?
In fact, you've put it correctly. I think we have to challenge the president and the prime minister. Put your money where your mouth is. You can't go on talking. We need action. But in recent times, look at what happened in URA. Look at what has happened in CAA. Look at what's happening in other organizations. There is a little bit of a process that is taking place. You can see, but it needs to be a little bit faster. Unfortunately for His Excellency, the people are with him. The people who are doing these things. It's a small clique of people. I don't want to use this word everybody is using. I'm fed up with it. But it's a group of people who are misbehaving, and they need to be called to order.
Are these people so powerful that the state can't train on them? Nobody mentions them. Everyone keeps on talking about a clique of people. Where do we find them?
Proving corruption is a very difficult game. You need good proof. You need all sorts of things. You need very good investigation. You need very good documentation. You need fair judiciary. You need you need people who have got this heart at country. Now, to do that, sometimes if you make a mistake, you can hurt government. But you know, you could be the same characters have infiltrated even the investigative machinery of government, and therefore give you wrong information, and you can carry out an action on the wrong people. So you need to sit down and come out with an elite group that can help you to try and investigate these problems. But what is unfortunate is action speaks louder than words. You might be looking for proof here and there, but you look around and you see somebody building a palace. You see somebody's got several cars, several wives, and so on. And then you begin to wonder, with his salary, how he can maintain this. Now, these are the kind of things that the government has to really sit down. And I remember there was a member of parliament who tried to move a motion that if you are found to be guilty of corruption, that they confiscate everything that you've got.
John Simba.
I don't remember who it was.
He lost his seat in
parliament. I don't remember who it was, but I think that came up. And unfortunately, even those who gives it lip service, some of them are involved in the whole thing. And we need to sit down and say, wait a minute. Uganda demands for better. And His Excellency the President has a very big job now. He has to answer that. In fact, a lot of people are saying, but that's the song. Every time the President is talking about corruption, nothing happens. So you need to show, when you talk about it, that there is action taking place.
Captain, without fear of contradiction, I would say the NRM government, with all its long stay in power, has learnt nothing from the governments that it toppled, because these, the challenges that we are experiencing as a country right now, are simply recall occurrences of what was happening in the past.
And not really. They are not the same. There is a difference. The NRM government in the 35 years, there are certain things that he has put in place. A lot of young people, including yourself, will not know where we've come from. But we've come from very far. And they have managed to maintain some sort of order in the country. And the country has been moving in the right direction. But within the same group of people, like I've just told you, within the same, they've been infiltrated by this selfish group of people who are not helping the situation. Now, from the 10-point program, which they came with, and they increased it a little bit more, so that it was a little bit wider, there has been a lot of implementation. And you can virtually use numbers to give. I don't want to go through it, because the president says it all the time. And people are saying, what do you expect? That's what he's going to say anyway. What has been registered shows that there is something that has been done. Of course we are human beings. We want it to be done quickly. We want to see action. But breaking a home, or breaking a house, takes one day. To build it takes nearly a year. So this country was virtually broken. Building it is not going to be easy. A lot of people do not realize, whenever you make a mistake, to bring back sanity and make the country, people have some sort of platform where they can build the country and even build themselves, it takes a long time. And you can see the example of Libya, you can see the example of Iraq, you can see the example of Syria now. If you play around with a nation, building it is not easy, and bringing it back to order. You can see the other day, the president snapped a finger and we all were locked in. Unlocking is not going to be easy. You see, sometimes you've got to think of the consequences of whatever you do.
Captain, that snapping means that the president has the power to take action. Why doesn't he snap the finger and then this whole thing goes away?
No, there's a difference. This, I'm sorry, I don't like this word mafia, but a lot of people have been using it. But just to bring our debate, these people who have infiltrated are not very stupid. They are very clever people. And sometimes they actually knit a picture to the president, because president works on information. He does not just jump to conclusions. And some of them have managed to convince the president now and then, and probably made him knock. It was until he has had an accident that he has realized, wait a minute, this was wrong advice. Now, I'm not trying to justify anything, but I'm trying to say that these guys are so clever. They infiltrate the intelligence system, they infiltrate investigative machinery, at one time they infiltrated the police, you heard that one. So with that, the president has got an uphill task, how to handle the situation. And you have to handle the situation slowly, because you can make a mistake that can cause bigger problems. So you've got to handle it within a reasonable
within reasonable measures.
So that you can get the right outcome. But I suppose, like some people say, sometimes that proverb in the Bible which says, "If you hide the stick, you spoil the kid." I suppose by being very civilized, some of the people do not get the answer. You need to get methods that can make them wake up.
One would wonder then, why could a country be civilized about dealing with corrupt individuals, but it is not very civilized when it is, for example, clamping down on its opponents?
I don't know about clamping down. Now, if you get young and you get some smart politician and they light a fire which can cause excitement and incite people, that, and in this kind of situation, it can be more costly, right, than this one individual you're looking for, this cockroach who is running around the government and spoiling it. I think it's a very good question. Now, whilst the incitement is easy to see, these people we're talking about, they are latent. They moved underground. They are not very easy. They are covert. They are not very nice people, and they are more dangerous than the opponent you're talking about.
Captain, as a young person or your viewer out there would wonder, granted, you've said the country has come a long way, and it's a given, everyone sees that. But one then would wonder, why is the country then, in terms of integrity and integrity and honesty, sinking this low? What is causing this misbehavior?
I think we've become complacent, and some of us who are in political leadership are more worried about being in power. And when we think about elections, that sometimes we close our eyes. I was very impressed when the president said, "Oh, you know, these borders are not the safest people to, but we've been looking on the other side because these young people would like to get jobs, but they are not the most safest means of transport. They are very uncomfortable, very dangerous, but we've kept our eyes." In other words, they know. But you see, you can't allow illegalities to go on because you are trying to help people. You're hiding behind this, "Oh, they are very poor, and therefore they should open shops on streets." I disagree with that. We are all very poor, we are all vulnerable, we all need, but does not mean we should break the law. And therefore, we must find ways and means of helping our vulnerable people. And that's why I was happy when the president wrote this real economy against vulnerable economy. So the vulnerable economy is what we are talking about. How do we help our people? But we should not break the law whilst helping them. We should do it within approved methods, where we sit down and plan. For example, in most of these countries, they've got markets. Yeah, markets for clothes, markets for this, markets for that. Very well established, where you go and you buy these things. So we don't need to put our people on the streets. We need to find a way to allow them to practice their trade, organized.
Captain, thank you very much. We are going to go for a very short break, but when we return, we shall be discussing the question of poverty. The NRM Manifesto 2016 was coined around the issue of job creation, modernization, and all this is anchored around trying to solve the poverty question. But this has been a song that we've sung since 1996, when we first went for the general elections under the new constitution, the 1995 constitution. We are going to go for a very short break. Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Today we are hosting Honorable Captain Francis Babu, and we are looking at the NRM implementation of the 2016-2021 manifesto. Captain, before we broke, we wanted to discuss the question of poverty. Why is it that it seems like the challenge has become insurmountable for your government? It's since 1996, or you would say 1986 when you came into power. The question of poverty, we've had themes change about poverty, strategies change. Every 5 years you change the strategy, but there seems no end in sight in trying to find a solution to this problem.
Very interesting. By the way, it is not my government, it's our government. And I think this is something I find that we, first and foremost, let's accept that this is our country, and whatever government is in power is our government. Secondly, poverty is everywhere in the world. That one you should not be told that is only in this country. Secondly, the other point that people never talk about, the population is increasing. When you talk about when NRM came in power and you had a population of about 14 million people, as opposed now to about nearly 45 million, there's an increase in population. An increase in population in the same place where the economy has been. Has there been an improvement? Yes. There are more people today working in the private sector than there were at the time when NRM came in power. And what the government has not been doing is to give us the numbers. They keep on giving us numbers, but they don't emphasize to show people what has happened. There are more factories in this country. There are more universities in this country. There are more communication companies in this country. And the telecommunication companies, all these people are employing Ugandans. But they are employing Ugandans of a certain caliber. And You see, Ugandans are not in one caliber. Our educated group is different. These universities are pumping people into the economy every day, and we need also to move us fast. Now, the president has tried very hard to invite investors here, as much as he's trying very hard, we now have got an economy, the vulnerable economy he's talking about. How do we encourage our people to utilize the other resources that we have so that they can be lifted? I was listening at a very nice expression, the American problem now they have. And Martin Luther King, many years in 1967, said the white Americans are telling them that the black people, the black Americans should pull themselves with the boots, should pull the string of their boots up. Then he said, how do you pull yourself when you don't have any boots
to put on?
So the other point is, how do we make our people move out of this poverty when they don't even have what it takes? Now, the first thing, and this is where I became very, very happy when you talked about the vulnerable group, is that the biggest employment part of our country is agriculture. And some of our people own small parcels of land. Now, government, instead of wasting a lot of time, they should put more emphasis in agriculture and sensitize our people that actually, instead of running around selling bananas and peanuts on the streets of Kampala, that they can make slightly better life by living on a piece of land. Now, government has also, in this regard, gone and taken people on absentee landlords' land and allowed the peasants to go there and paid off the landlords. That has been going on. So there are many methods that have been used and multi-pronged approaches to try and fight poverty. Land is one of them. And in fact, I was happy because when I listened to Martin Luther King, he said, these guys never, you know, when the slave trade ended, they never gave us anything. Whilst the peasants from the Europe were being given land in the Western United States. So the whole point was, how do we help our people? How do we convince you, Wasajja, for example, that if Wasajja, you had so much piece of land and we taught you how to do a bit of agriculture and grow crops, and we also teach you how to process that those crops, you could have a better life than selling groundnuts and bananas on the streets of Kampala. Now, this is where government has to come in with this vulnerable economy. He talks about food, he talks about clothes, he talks about shelter, and all these things. Now, Ugandans should be made aware that they are very lucky compared to other parts of the world. We still have food in this country. And if we emphasized agriculture and food processing in this country, people would have a better life. And then the industries which the government is pushing so hard, so that there is, for example, he quoted an example of making marble from Karamoja. That marble alone, if it's well done and employed enough people, it could actually increase the GDP of this economy. The other things we're talking about is our oil, which is still underground. Now, again, what were the problems? If oil was here, they would be able to support agriculture, they would be able to support other things. Now, our friends, the Arabs, woke up some time back. All the money they got from the oil, they built their countries. That today, all of you Ugandans are running to Dubai. And sometimes I wonder why, because these are skyscrapers which have been built in sand. You've got everything here, and you have failed to develop your country. Therefore, we are all responsible. It's not only President Museveni, all of us.
Captain, you raise a very good point, especially on agriculture, but I would say it seems government's priorities are elsewhere. For example, when you look at the budget that has been passed today, it is security, infrastructure that are on top of the list. Agriculture, you would say, is one of... the funding, our budgeting doesn't seem to be speaking what you're proposing as a solution?
When you are sitting in a government, you look at priorities. To be able to fund agriculture, you need to look for money from some other place. And to do that, the fastest way of getting that money is by making sure that you have an infrastructure that can support economic enterprises that can bring in money to support the agriculture and to support other economic ventures. So, as far as I'm concerned, if the priorities of government is to have infrastructure, that is electricity, roads, and other things that go with it, to try and help so that we can have factories, like have a marble factory which requires electricity, that like having electricity in West Nile, where they have very good agricultural products, so that we can have food processing in West Nile. And if we can also do that, rural electrification schemes, and our people can be able to do food processing, I think you are getting there. So it depends on your priority, and I think the conclusion of it all is that the economy is managing scarce resources. So we have scarce resources, we have to manage them. Therefore, we've got to have priorities. What comes first, the chicken or the egg? And this is the argument that Ugandans must look at. What can we do to try and get money from the right direction and put it in where it matters, where the vulnerable economy must be built? So I think those are the priorities. And I think people should look it that way. However, the president has one problem. There's a very big virus called corruption in all that.
Captain, you have a very well nicely written document called the NRM Manifesto.
Yes.
What purpose does it serve? Because, well, in as like I initially said, in as much as it has these good themes and these good strategies, but we seem to be going nowhere.
The implementation of it. I think what you're saying is that there is a nice blueprint, but we are not putting it in effect. No, it has been put in effect, except not as fast as you'd wish. And I agree with you. Human beings, you know, our life is so short that we cannot wait for 50 years, 60 years. We want to see action. And as the Englishman says, action is speaks louder than words. And I think this is where the word letter doesn't apply. People want to see things happening. And that is why this speech of the president, the last speech on the state of the nation, was completely different compared to the old one. He has now realized that people don't want to hear the other stuff. They want to hear action. They want to see action. They want to see something being done. You know, we need to implementation. And we are tired of a sing-song. There's this, there's that. And he should clean his act and get the country moving.
Captain, besides the development side, the governance question. One is, in as much as your document highlights that we shall observe good governance and ensure that we have in place all these governance structures, but still there is something that is missing. I mean, for example, everyone thought that by 2021, we shall be having the president. The president will be 75 years, so will not come back, will not seek re-election. This was amended. We did not even have the chance to test the term limits and how they work. And this was amended. Human rights issues. Why is this so?
Another priority. You know, we should stop being copycat. Who tells us? Well, why do we follow others? What is good for our country? Is our priority to build Uganda, or our priority is to practice other people's models? Yeah? You know, even the democracy you talk about, the French democracy is different from the British, is different from the American, is different from the now we have the Chinese, who are number two in the world in terms of the economy. They have a completely different model. The question is it our model the problem, or is it the people who are the problem? And this is where I completely disagree, that we waste so much time on who is supposed to be the leadership. I think the man in leadership should be accountable. And this business of two terms, three terms is good if the country is already at a certain level. We need to build this. And I think President Nyerere at one time says, you know, Africans have a problem. They worry about non-issues. How do we build the country? Is having the president there, can we build this country? Can he help us to build this country? By removing him, what happens? Do we build the country? You see, there's this thing, if you change him, we build the country. Does change mean building this country? You could even change for the worst. So the whole point I am concerned about, whilst we work on the democracy that you people admire, the utopian European democracy or American democracy, let us first build our country so that we build a house, not on sand, but on a rock. And within, but there's one certain things that have come into play. For the first time in this country, every 5 years, we have an election. That to me is very, very important in the democracy that you people aspire to have. Number two, it doesn't matter, let me go. Although there are mistakes in those elections, but they are there. The next thing is going to come, that after we have built this country and we've become firm, then we can say, Captain Babu, thank you very much. The two terms are over. Goodbye. And the Captain Babu can say, well, yes, I'll make it two terms. Once I set that ball rolling, after this president has gone, we can come up with that. It's not something that is elusive, that will disappear. It's something we can get to. But to me, the most important is to build the foundation and the pillars that hold this country together.
How long is the foundation going to take to build?
I told you that breaking this country took us, we got independence in 62. By 1966, we had virtually scattered this country. By 1970, there was no Uganda anymore. And we started going downhill. Since then, we've been trying to build. And we would like to build this country. It doesn't matter how long it takes. You see, the trouble is, don't equate building a country to your life. Our lives are short compared to a country. This country, the British democracy has taken 850 years. The American is 350 years and he has never stabilized. So as far as I'm concerned, this business, how long will it take? As long as it takes, as long as we build a good, a well-founded, with a very good foundation, with very good pillars, the country will eventually get to the levels where you want it to get.
Well, we are going to continue this conversation after the short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Today we are talking to Honorable Captain Francis Babu about the implementation of the NRM Manifesto 2016-2021. Captain, in the 2016 Manifesto, the NRM promised Ugandans that by 2020, they would have leaped into a middle-income status.
Mm-hmm.
Going by the statistics, we are nowhere near that. Why?
That's what they call weather forecasting. You forecast that there's going to be rain or there's going to be sun tomorrow and it doesn't come. When they did it, actually, I did not agree with it because I looked at the foundation and what we had said and this country was not there yet. And I wanted to give you an example. You see, if the foundation is strong enough and the pillars holding the country are strong enough, even if you change the heads of state, the country stays there. And example, a very good example is Italy. Italy, every 6 months, they change prime ministers. But the country continues on the same road. But even then, it disturbs the country. One of the problems the economy of Italy has got is changing of leadership. They change them so fast that there's no stability in terms of the country moving forward. And therefore, in Europe, Italy and Spain and Greece are at the cusp of their economy. So, at the end of the day, you need to build these pillars and eventually build the leadership so that it is strong enough. And to get there, it takes a little bit of time. And I don't want to quote countries right now, but there's a country which changes presidents every 4 years. Change them, and when they remove the other president and they got another president, they're having problems one after the other. So it does not really, it's not a sure banker that if you change the president, the country will now, it will begin to sail. No, I think what we need to really work on and I would like to see this happen. How do we get the foundation of the country, the pillars that hold it, and then we can move on to that other part of the roof of trying to get leaders to change as we go on. And during that time, even if we are at that level trying to learn how to change leaders, the country is stable.
But Captain, in Africa, most of the countries that have had leaders that have overstayed, some of them actually built the foundations for good development, you would say, but when they left, well, everything is now in shambles.
No, that's, so that's a fallacy.
Aren't we going to take that?
That's a fallacy. If you take Tanzania, for example, in building the foundation and uniting Tanzania, a lot of things were lost. They lost a lot of things, and they lost the economy, for example. But what they built is now sustainable. Now Tanzania is on where you people want to be, change leaders every 10 years, because the foundation was firm. Now, Kenya had a lot of problem because the people who were in leadership towards the end did not build that very strong foundation. It is now that they are trying, even now as we talk, they still have a problem. So you've got two countries you can look at. When we had more instability in the whole of the three countries in East Africa, therefore, we need to build our foundation so that it is at par, let's say, with Tanzania. In doing so, you will lose one or two things. But if you achieve that foundation and those pillars, eventually, the leadership, no matter what you do, after His Excellency the President has gone, we are going to get those 10 years.
Captain, let's take Libya, for example, or Somalia with Saidi Barre.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the narrative that you're giving us is that once you have someone that has overstayed for long and they have built the pillars, then, but negating on the governance question, then you're good to
but
go.
You see,
but it is
but
not
do,
the
do you
same
you see the
story.
Difference? The interference into Libya was done by foreigners. And in fact, one of those leaders, he regrets why they destabilized Libya. The guy had managed to build a foundation, and had he got away, they were already on a very good foundation. But they used the divide and rule of Libya, and the foreigners came and actually destabilized that government. And that government has never had the light of day since ever since. Now, if you look at Saidi Barre, same thing. Again, divide and rule between tribes. For them, actually, it is not even tribes, it's on clans. Now, all these things are built in by people who have got interests. So you need leaders, and this is my argument. Even the leaders who are in the opposition, we need good leaders who can build this country so that our dream of having the utopian democracy, a good democracy, will be built on that foundation. In other words, let's build our house on the rock, not in the sand. If you build it on the sand because you are dying to keep on changing leadership, it will fall down and will start all over again. It will fall down and will start all over again. That's why Tanzania is now got a very good foundation. It was built on a very good foundation by an honest and a truthful leader. And that's what we need in this country.
So don't you think it's this long stay that was used as an excuse for foreign interference that
no.
we should not take
no,
that,
no,
that
no.
we should not take
no.
a chance on?
The foreign interference was because of the riches of Libya, yeah, and the one of Somalia, because it is a strategic point for the Indian Ocean. The reasons are completely different and they're hidden. The one of Libya is strictly out of riches. They wanted those minerals. And the people who did it is because they were being virtually curtailed by the guy who was in leadership. And I thought that he made a mistake by telling them what he wanted to do.
So, Captain, why is it that we are not realizing what you promised us in 2016? For example, the middle income that we've been talking about.
No. The middle income, I think the forecast was based on wrong premises. Again, this is whereby they give you the wrong information and you think about middle income. But the middle income will come, but I thought the time was short. Yeah? It is something that is going to come a little bit forward, somewhere in the forward. That's why the foundation and the speed at which you must do these things must increase a little bit so that you can lay the foundation quicker and therefore you can bring this middle status income. It will take some time. It will not take one day.
So what strategies would you propose to ensure that, to advise that the country leaps forward to the vision and goals that they aspire
for? My first thing is that we must have patriotic leaders. Patriotic leaders who are not selfish, people who think about this country, and they build this country right from the foundation, where we've already got some sort of foundation, but build it so that it's strong enough and they've got very strong pillars that can hold the country in one piece. And those are the people we are looking for. In fact, I think we need more good leadership than anything else.
So how do you build patriotic leaders? Because I'll give you an example that if I am a student and or if I'm an ordinary citizen, but I look at all this looting of public resources, you don't think I'll be patriotic. So how do you advise that, especially the young people, can be built into patriotic leaders?
In fact, you've just made a very good point. That is where the integrity comes in. That's where these parasites must be fought. But I think when you want to change people's attitude, first of all, you must set examples. You must have a good team. Secondly, how, for example, if we wanted Uganda today, the whole of Uganda to speak Swahili, how would we start doing it? If we want the whole of Uganda to be patriotic and they love their country and they stop looking at this bad example, you must start somewhere. Even if you are going 1,000 miles, you must make the first step. And the first step must come. And the president now, if he wants, is not, in fact, we should not even talking about changing him. Can he change the methods of work? Can he change how people, you know, how people get the perception of this country? The perception is totally wrong, and our people have got completely wrong perception. In fact, every time the president comes on TV, I've been hearing young people say, he's going to say the same thing anyway. Until recently, when he had the state of the, say, oh, this time it's different. Now, that is a beginning. And by the way, there's no school for leaders. You learn on the job. And because you learn on the job, training, you must be able to be very exact, virtually try as hard as possible to do the right things.
Don't you think we've had a very bad experience with leaders that are learning on the job?
Yes, we have. But some of them are good. You see, you know, this parliament has got 450 people or so. Not all of them are bad. You will be surprised. The majority of them are very good people. All they need to do is to get a cue from a good leader, and this country would change.
Captain, as we are winding up, the issue of COVID-19 has virtually disrupted all aspects of our lives. As an elder in the party and in the country as well, how would you advise the country can recover itself?
Well, first of all, it has taught us a lesson. That our priorities might be wrong. And the priority that I realized during the COVID-19 is that the most important thing in our lives is our food. You must eat. You must have somewhere to stay. Now, this alone has made us wake up. Where do we put our money? What do we do? Now, what is very important? Even the rich went on their knees because of COVID-19. Even the vulnerable went on their knees. In fact, there was no difference between a homeless and the rich people. We all went on our knees. And some of us also learned how to pray. So our spiritual inside, inner self, must change. We must love this country. All of us must now wake up and say, Uganda is our country. We don't have any other country. We should build it, and we should be truthful. And we should be fair. The other day, I laughed when I saw them reducing the pay of the director of KCCA from, 40,000 to something like half the amount. I said, now why? Why did you put it there in the first place? So these are the kind of issues that we need to check the mistakes we've made. And you learn from mistakes. I'm not saying that what you have done is perfect. But please don't get me wrong. I'm not painting that the president is right. He is also human. He makes mistakes. But he should correct his mistakes. And our oppositions also should correct their methods of work. So We need to show Ugandans that leaders in this country are interested in Uganda. And who's Uganda? The people of Uganda. How are we going to help them? How do we help the vulnerable? How can we be sincere to them? And it is that sincerity with the honesty and truthfulness and fairness that is going to help this country. So we need more people like that.
Captain, on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate the NRM's performance in this term, 2016-2021, in terms of security, governance, and development?
Well, each one of those is got a different number. You cannot give one number for all of them. For example, you cannot add them and then say, security would have a different percentage, the economy would have a different percentage, everything would have a different percentage. They're not going to be the same. But speaking frankly, they're between 6 and about 8, depending on which area you want to talk about. The security has been reasonable. Our economy has not done very well because of interference. Negotiations for our economy, for example, like the oil, I am not very happy with the way it has been negotiated, although the president has tried to protect this country, but it seems there are others who are making it difficult for him. The issue of the lorry, the standard gauge lorry, the issue of the pipeline. The reason why I'm talking about this, oil can help us as a catalyst to improve our development. Not to consume oil, the money we get out of it, but to put the money into other sectors of our development so that we can have a good foundation.
Do you think we have the pillars and strategies in place to ensure that we utilize these oil resources as much as we can?
I'm sure we can. This is where, you remember, you know, we're wasting so much time trying to fight who should be in leadership. And we have failed to build those pillars. When we build one, then suddenly we run to, we are fire brigading. We are not doing it consistently and moving at the same time. We should sit down and build this country, all of us, and we should respect each other. I think we have a very big problem. And by the way, it starts with our leadership. NRM itself has to clean its act. I have no problem with some of the opposition. The opposition, their job is to try and criticize government and criticize who is in leadership. Yesterday I saw something which was very interesting. I saw one of the opposition parties when they did the one knee act against black people not breathing. I agree entirely. Africa, has the knee is on Africa, and these Western countries have not allowed us to breathe.
Captain, your parting shot in 1 minute.
I think our party needs to change its act. They need to become a little bit more serious. It's sometimes, I think it is even amorphous. I was looking at the Tanzanian party, the way they choose their leadership. I was extremely impressed.
Are you giving them a vote of no confidence?
No. I'm saying they should improve. No, please, whenever you criticize something, they should be room for improvement. I think there are certain things that should be looked at and say, look, here we've gone wrong, let's put it right. And I think that's where it is very, very important.
Thank you.
And we've got very good leaders in this country, by the way. Very good ones. And
so if we have very good leaders, why do we consistently have one supreme leader?
The method of getting them. How do we do it? By getting our leaders on board. And after bringing them on board, how do we build them to become even better leaders? I think it has to be done deliberately, like growing a plant. How do we grow leaders? How do we get them?
Captain, we cannot continue this conversation. We thank you for making time to the show.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching Urban TV and The Checkpoint.
The point I wanted to say, I'd like to send our condolences to Burundi. Lost their president.
Sure.
It's very unfortunate. And this country has helped Burundi quite a bit. And I think our condolences go to Nkurunziza's family and the Burundian people. And we hope that he will rest in peace. And we hope his death will not create more problems in Burundi, that instead he has fought to see Burundi become united, that they'll become united. Thank you very much.
With that, we cannot continue this conversation. Have a good night.